We are starting with the OFDM. So the objective of this set of slides is just to give you an introduction about the OFDM system. How does it work? And the important building blocks, important operations that happens within an OFDM system. Okay? And then at the end, you can, if you have any questions related to your project or anything like that related to OFDM, please feel free to ask. And I will feel free to answer what I know, and I will not answer what I don't know, because I don't know everything. Okay? We will see. Now, quickly, this is kind of a bookkeeping, advantages versus disadvantages of OFDM. Okay? Before going into this table and discuss the advantages and the disadvantages, and then as we go through the coming slides, we will see why these advantages and disadvantages exist. Just quickly, what's an OFDM system? It's a multi-carrier system. And typically, multi-carrier systems are operating, number one, they operate by allocating each bit. So again, don't get confused between the carriers that we talk about here, which are called sub-carriers or sub-band carriers, okay? As opposed to the carrier, which is like the 2.4 carrier where you put your signal. So when we talk OFDM, we are talking carriers with very small frequencies, of course, relatively small, okay? And those frequencies of the carriers are used to compose still a baseband signal. It's not a passband signal. Did not move up in frequency. It's only using those subcarriers, the signal is getting wider and wider, but still baseband. So the OFDM signal is a baseband signal. It's still not multiplied by the final carrier, which happens at the end stage of your transmitter. That's number A, because I mentioned number one before. Okay. Number B, those subcarriers are selected such that, or those small carriers are selected such that each one of them is going to carry one bit of your signal. So what's happening is, instead of sending, for example, 6 bits, or let's pick a number which is a power of 2. So instead of sending 8 bits in serial, one after the other, okay, within a duration equal to 8 times the bit duration B, right? So if I start, if I'm trying to send a sequence of 8 bits, okay? Of course, they can be ones or zeros. I'm just trying to show you that it has a certain duration, and they should be adjacent to each other. So each one starts at the end of the other, okay? Right. 8, okay? So if I tell you that one bit duration is B, then the total duration here is going to be what? 8B, right? 8 times B, right? Okay, because this is a sequence of 8 bits. And again, they are one after the other. There is no spacing. I'm only showing this to show you that they are 8 different bits, okay? But they are actually the start of one of them is the end of the next, the previous one. Okay, so instead of doing it this way, instead of sending them this way, you can do this. Right? Up to 8, right? Okay. Each one of these is going to have a duration 8B. Okay? But how do you separate them? Because you have to send them now at the same time, such that they eventually consume all of them 8B. So what you will do is multiply this by carrier 1, multiply this by carrier 2, multiply this by carrier 3, multiply this by carrier 8, right? So you end up putting each one of them in a frequency band different from the other, right? Okay? So you multiply each one of them by a different subcarrier. These are what we call them, the subcarriers, right? And then you can send them all at the same time, right? So they will all consume again 8 bits. Okay? Got the idea? Now, when you span an 8-bit duration in time, 4 bit for a single bit, what becomes the frequency band approximately of this one? What's going to be, what's the effect of the frequency version of this bit as compared to the frequency version of this bit?
It's 1 over 8.
Exactly. Because basically, we have something called the time frequency multiplication, right? Typically, the multiplication of the frequency band times the time duration is a constant. So if you scale frequency down, if you make frequency smaller, time must expand with the same ratio. If you scale time up, this means that frequency is scaling down with the same ratio. So here, we scale the time of 1 bit by 8 times. It must be that the frequency representation of this bit is going to have a bandwidth which is 1 over 8 of the bandwidth of this one, right? So now we have 1 over 8 of the bandwidth, but then we are putting them one after the other in the frequency, okay? Such that the total band is going to be, this is 1 over 8 plus 1 over 8 plus 1 over 8, you get the overall bandwidth B, right? And for this one, the bandwidth per transmission, right, is equal to B as well, right? Because each one of those occupies a bandwidth B, right? Over a duration of 8 bits. And here again, duration and time is 8 bits. Spanning and frequency is B, bandwidth as it is, right? So we did not really change or lose anything in terms of neither bandwidth nor timing. So speed of transmission is the same. Bandwidth is almost the same. Okay? So what did we gain? What's the gain of doing this? So the bandwidth of this is, okay, each one of those will have B over 8 in frequency. Right? So the total bandwidth here is gonna 8 times B divided by 8, which is equal to B, right? And the total time duration is this 8B. Similarly here, the total time duration is 8B, and the bandwidth of any one of them is B. Right? Let's call the bandwidth BW, عشان ما حدش يجد confused between B and B. BW. Okay. So basically, I was able to send 8 bits during time duration 8 times the bit duration and using a bandwidth equal to BW, right? Here, I was able to send 8 bits during duration 8B, right? And using a bandwidth equal to BW. So I did not gain or lose anything. Where is the gain? Why do I do all the multi-carrier. We did not talk about the fact that it is orthogonal. That's one extra thing. But why do we do multi-carrier?
Sometimes if the channel is frequency selective, I can raise the power force for specific carriers to overcome the channel frequency selective.
Sometimes if the channel is
frequency selective,
raise.
To overcome that part, for example, of the bandwidth, I can raise the power for a specific carrier. So I can overcome the frequency selection problem.
It overcomes a certain fading problem, but it has nothing to do with the power, neither the frequency selectivity.
Interference.
Yes. Intersymbol interference, that happens because of
multipath.
Okay. So what happens is,
does anyone understand the phenomena of interference, intersymbol interference?
What happens in the intersymbol interference?
I send a signal. Goes straight away to my receiver, but at the same time it goes, bumps on the wall and then goes.
Yes, so that's a multipath. And yes. Then the end result is?
End result is, like I have two versions of the same signal, but shifted.
Okay.
Shifted, and then they are summed in my electronics.
Yes.
So I need to separate this so they don't come over each other.
Okay. No, you don't want to separate the two versions of the same signal. You want to make sure that this is eventually gonna cause your signal to become a little bit wider, right? And if your signal,
if your pulse becomes wider such that it significantly interferes with the next one, then this is gonna cause errors in detecting the next one at the receiver, right? Because again,
remember that we always decode by sampling at the middle of our bit duration, right? So if this is 1 bit, right? And this bit, because of inter-symbol interference, becomes a little bit wider like this, okay? So this is because of time spreading over the channel, right? The next bit is immediately starting here, right? And it goes like this. This is the middle point where I will read the value of the next bit, right? Now, the middle point is far enough from that spreading. So probably the spreading is not going to cause any error. So that's okay. But if the spreading becomes wider such that it looks like this, for example, right? Then this is going to cause an error at my sampling. Assume that the next bit, this one, assume that this bit was a zero and the previous one was a one and it's interfering all this way. So basically when I sample here, I will read something that will give me a decision of a one, which is incorrect, right? So in order to overcome this problem, my only option is to do what? Move this guy away, right? Such that the middle point cannot be affected by the previous spreading, right? That's what we did here. So here, one bit over the first carrier becomes much wider, right? And then the next bit, of every 8 bits, there is going to be another bit on the same carrier, right? But the separation between the middle of this one and the middle of the next one is further as compared to the separation between one bit and the next one, right? So pair sub-channel, okay? This is where time interference can happen, right? Because as you move across channels, you are separated in frequency. So no interference in terms of time domain, right? The only interference is going to happen within the same channel. This bit and the next one. So the next one will become wider, for example, by this duration, right? But I've made this very wide and the next one very wide, such that the distance between the middle of this one and the next one is going to be far enough to be away from the spreading factor. Right? So basically, by doing this, I am avoiding the inter-symbol interference effect, which happens because of spreading of the time spreading of the signals, right? This is why they use, and this is a typical problem in high multipath situations, such as indoor, that's why they use it in the Wi-Fi, or in urban areas where you are in downtown, for example, and lots of buildings, so lots of reflections and so on. Okay, so that's the advantage of multi-carrier communication. Now the problem becomes if you look at a pulse which is a square and then it's centered around a frequency, F1, right? And then a next pulse which is the square of the same width centered around frequency, F2, you will notice that they will look like this. Each one of them is going to give you in the frequency a sync function, right? Okay, so this is the first pulse in frequency domain, and it will look like a sync function, right? And then the next pulse in frequency domain is also a sync function. Okay, if you want them, if you want them to be separated, okay, then you should make sure that the next one is away, such that between this center and this center, there is a distance which is double the bandwidth, right? Okay?
Between the center of this one and the next one, right? And this way, you will end up with a bandwidth here which is expanded. In order to make sure that the bandwidth is efficiently used, if you pick those frequencies such that the zero of one of them occurs at the peak of the other one, right? Then you can bring them close, and the distance between them is going to be only b, right? And this is the concept of orthogonality. That happens when these carriers are multiples of each other. So this happens when, if you pick a frequency f for the first subcarrier, for this one, you pick for the second one 2f, 3f, 4f, and so on. These are called orthogonal carriers. Why? Because as cosine functions, if you take the inner product between cosine omega and cosine 2 omega, over one period, it will become equal to zero. Similarly between 1 and 3, similarly between 2 and 3, right? So any multiples of the same fundamental frequency, they are orthogonal carriers, right? So this is why, that's for bandwidth efficiency, this is why we call this orthogonal frequency division multiplex, okay? So it's basically an orthogonal multi-carrier system. So now we have described why we use multi-carrier, how does it work, right? And what's the niche of orthogonal frequency division multiplex, which is an orthogonal multicarrier? Okay. Any questions in this before we quickly discuss adventures, then move into details of the system? Any questions on the general concept? Yes.
Thomas, ملتي كارير ديريشن وقاعد ياخذ مثلا اف تايمز 2 اف 3 اف ان اف
تمام
في الارتجل بياخذ نفس الشيء شو الفرق بينهم
لا في المالتي كارير ما بيبقاش كده
ما ياخذ
لا 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 إيه لما بياخذ اف 2 اف 3 اف صغر ذس از ان اورثوجونال مالتي كارير
اه اوكي
اوكي
يعني هذا بيكون تقريبا يعني نفس اف دي ام بس نفس الكاريرز
اه هو اكشولي في الثاني هتلاقيه هيبيك فريكوانسي وبعدين هيبيك فريكوانسي تاني at least 2F away لأنه عنده الكونديشن اللي هو إنه مش عارف he wants to separate them by 2D 2W تمام لكن في المالتي كارير he is able to do it one step at a time because he takes orthogonal frequency which are multiple of each other.
I see
that
like loss of efficiency caused by cyclic prefix which is in O of the
N. خلينا نتكلم لسه عن cyclic prefix وبعدين نتناقش خلاص لسه it's coming in the details okay so just keep the question so you can ask it in time okay
now if any problems happen in the frequency domain like shifts small shifts like even really really small shift it will interfere with the other ones and it will not be coordinate
how yes and no now going back to what you mentioned okay for the actual signal if you look at the actual overall signal tamam what happens here is you have a signal with a light band right and if your channel is kind of for example moving with high speed okay so if you are moving with if you are within a very dense multipath environment okay because what affects the frequency response of the channel is the multipath effect what affects the time response of the channel is the mobility so it's opposite to what you would expect but this is the case because mobility causes Doppler shift But Doppler shift results in a channel time domain behavior, not frequency domain behavior. Okay. Vice versa, multipath effect is actually doing some time spreading, but this affects the channel frequency domain behavior. Okay. I'll probably, if we finish this and we have like 10 minutes at the end, I'm going to describe to you those concepts, the time and the frequency domain behavior of the channel. Because they are typically concepts that relate to wireless communication rather than digital communication. But if we have time, I will tell you briefly about them. So anyways, what I was saying is, by doing this, you can imagine that if you look at each one of these as a channel by itself, right? That channel has typically a smaller bandwidth or a larger bandwidth?
Smaller
bandwidth, right? So if you look at each one of those sub-channels as a channel with smaller bandwidth, you can think that if your channel frequency behavior is very quick, right? Typically, you don't want the channel to change the communication channel. You don't want it to change during the bandwidth of the signal, right? So what happens here is by making the bandwidth of every subcarrier smaller, the channel becomes more or less as if it is flat for you, right? And this is exactly the frequency domain behavior which corresponds to the fact that you are more resilient to inter-single interference, okay? So that time behavior, the fact that you are resilient to inter-single interference, comes from the fact that you make your sub-channels, or basically independent channels, the ones at the different carriers, you make each one of them small as compared to the channel behavior, the channel frequency behavior. So your channel becomes as if it is still random, but their sub-channel is almost a constant, right? It doesn't fluctuate within the sub-channel. Which is exactly the frequency correspondence of that the symbols do not interfere with each other. So this comes similarly to that. The actual bad effect in multi-carrier or basically RDM is that it's very sensitive to high-speed mobility. So high-speed mobility has problems here. You have to overcome it using other things. Right? You have to do something in addition to this to overcome the high-speed effect, which causes Doppler effect.
High mobility is like when you drive a car and...
Yeah, cars typically are fine, because up to like 150 kilo is proper. But imagine, for example, airplanes. So you are communicating from airplanes, or you are communicating from like space shuttles or whatever, which is moving at very, very high relative speeds, okay? In that case, OFDM requires additional things to work. It's very sensitive to that situation. Any other questions?
Okay, so Now, some of the advantages, it's of RDM that it works in severe channel conditions such as the ones that we mentioned right now, particularly for inter-symbol interference. It's robust against narrowband co-channel interference. So if you have, because of the fact that you spread your signal, right, across different channels, if you have something which is interfering with a particular frequency, it's not going to hit a set of consecutive bits, right? It's going to hit a set of bits which comes one every 8 bits, right? And typically with error correction codes or channel coding, you can overcome these kind of errors, right? So that's why it's more robust to interference, but narrowband interference, the one that hits one of the subbands, for example, but not all the subbands at the same time. Okay? This is what we call narrowband interference. It's robust against ISI, and we just described this, and this comes from the fading effect, right? So it's robust against fading. It has high spectral efficiency because of the orthogonality between the multi-carriers, right? Can be implemented efficiently using FFT. We will see this in the coming slides. How does the orthogonal frequency division multiplexing map into very simple implementation in the baseband design? Okay. Has no sensitivity to time synchronization errors. Why?
Because the time domain is now larger, so any
exactly
mismatch in time sampling will not, like, I'll stay, most probably, I'll exactly stay on the same.
Yeah, exactly.
It's tuned, sub-channel receiver.
Filters are not required, unlike conventional FDM.
Now, this has to do with the efficient implementation using FFT. Okay? Because this you would need to do it if you were not able to do FFT and you had actually to generate local carriers and local filters such that you can do these, right? But now when you do the UFDM using FFT, you are no longer in need for this, okay?
Now some of the limitations are it's sensitive to depth shift, as I mentioned to you, so mobility has a really, really bad effect on UFDM and you have to overcome that by doing something in addition to simply doing an OFDM. You have to add something to the OFDM system, okay?
It's sensitive to frequency synchronization problems. You can imagine why, so don't forget. It's not sensitive to time synchronization, but it's sensitive to frequency synchronization. Why?
You have multiple carriers and you have a carrier that you modulate with.
Yeah, if something happens that causes these carriers to become non-orthogonal, the whole system collapses, right? So the whole system is built on the fact that those bits are carried on orthogonal carriers, right? That allowed us to do that efficient usage of the bandwidth, right? Imagine if they don't become orthogonal, then in frequency they will interfere with each other, right? This thing will become wide enough such that it becomes interfering with the other one, right? So if anything shifts the frequencies from their locations or causes disruption to this frequency structure of the OFDM, the whole system collapses. Okay, so that's why it's sensitive to frequency synchronization. High peak to average power ratio, I will describe it to you when we reach there. Why it happens and what do we mean by it, okay? So that's a big disadvantage in OFDM system. And the last thing is that you lose some of your efficiency of the OFDM system due to the usage of, why? Time to take a break. So last thing, why you lose efficiency? Because the slide does not provide that information, so we'll say it anyways until this comes back. So you lose efficiency because of the fact that you are adding redundancy, right? You could have sent only those symbols if you made them one after the other. But to overcome some problems, you had to take some of the symbols and repeat them, right? And that means you are sending something which is not necessary. So you are wasting part of your available time or bandwidth for something that does not provide extra useful information, right? So that's redundancy, hence it's a reduction in efficiency, in rate efficiency, right? Okay. So now we have mentioned what's an OFDM system in terms of just the general overall concept, and we talked about some of the advantages and disadvantages. Some of those will appear more or will become clearer as we move on into the details. Then we will start now talking about the internal details of the system, one by one, okay? Once
this comes back. So you can take 3 minutes to wait.
Yes. These are examples of currently existing systems that are using OFDM as the core of the technology. So you have the 802.11 AGN and the European standard, which disappeared for wireless LAN. It was called HyperLAN. No longer, you don't have products with that standard anymore. So the IEEE 802.11 dominated the standards. There is also the digital radio system, which is currently being introduced into consumers, so the equipment and the technology and the standards are everything are defined, but the widespreading of digital radio is still taking some time. Okay, there is also the TV system, and that includes the satellite as well as the terrestrial, so the local. So there is DVB-H, DVB-T, and there is another DVB. There are other standards, which is the ISDB, but those are different kind of standards. But there is DVB-T and DVB-H, and there is one more. I don't remember what was the third one, but these has to do with, you know, those receivers that you have at home, right? So currently, most of these receivers are used to receive from a satellite system, right? But there are actually newer technology, which is using RDM, where it's not a satellite, it's a local broadcast, similar to the old, you remember the old TV, the old analog TV. So this is kind of a digital TV. This is designed particularly to cover areas where cable TV does not exist. Okay, because the problem with satellite is that it has a little bit limited availability in bad weather conditions. But that local, which is on Earth, it will still work even under bad. So satellite, if you have really very dense overcast, if you have lots of accumulation of clouds, right? And during thunderstorms, you can experience outages in satellite, right? Sometimes even during solar storms, right? So the local one, the one which is gonna be ground to ground, will not experience the same kind of problems, okay? There is also the cellular system, particularly the LTE and the LTE advanced systems, right? So the 4G, LTE is long-term resolution. This is one of the names of 4G system, okay? And the LTE advanced is kind of an evolution over the evolution. So this is the advanced version of this one, which is also being deployed in many places. There is the HSOPA and HSDPA. I think this should be D. So HSDPA, which is... it exists in many places now. It's intermediate stage between the 3GPP, 3G, and the full LTE. So there is an intermediate stage, which was called high-speed data packet access, HSDPA. Okay. Of course, the wireless metropolitan area network, such as the 802.16, the WiMAX. This one did not make it. I mean, there was a big hype on WiMAX probably like 6-7 years ago, but and there was lots of deployments and so on, but somehow the LTE and the 4G took over, and it was applied and deployed faster, fully supported by the big companies which are providing the services, such that eventually the WiMAX actually did not make it to a good amount of market, so it died before being born.
The WiMAX with the very wide range Wi-Fi?
It's like metropolitan, yes, but it's different from Wi-Fi. It has a fixed, not a statistical access, it has a fixed access, so time-slotted access rather than contention-based access.
Time division.
Yes, yeah. So, but it never made it to really wide markets. So it came out, companies were there developing the systems, deploying them, and then eventually LTE wiped everything. So
it's kind of, many companies actually closed because of WiMAX. And last thing is personal, so wireless personal area networks. These are kind of very small scale. One of these is the ultra wide band technology, the 802.15.3. And 802.15 in general, you will find underneath that the Bluetooth, right? Some of the existing systems, right? But versions, certain versions of Bluetooth, because
typically Bluetooth uses CDMA instead of RDMA. Okay? But there are certain versions of Bluetooth that uses this. Okay?
What does O02 indicate? Like all of them?
You mean 802?
802.
Yeah. I don't remember the codes. I don't remember the codes, but I remember that when you talk about 802, right, you are talking about a wireless standard that covers something less than wide area network. So this is why you have it here, 802.16, 802.20, 802.15, and so on. So 802 is basically, if I remember correctly, it's the IEEE code which is used to wireless standards that covers anything other than wide area network. So wide area network is covered by the LTE and the 3GPP groups, right? But those 802 are typically metropolitan or local area or personal area networks. Okay. You can look up those codes on the IEEE standards website. You will be able to figure out exactly what does the first digits represent, the second digits, and so on. Again, not only OFDM is used in wireless, but it's also used in wired communication. Now, the most famous example among the wired communication cases, the most relevant one, are DVB-C. That's the one that I was looking for. Is the ADSL. You remember the ADSL lines before the fiber, which made it these days to home? It used to be you have those four lines, which are basically your connection, and they work at like 1, 4, or sometimes even they can reach up to 10 megabits per second, right? So those are using, on the wire, they are using OFDM technology, okay? Also, the cable system for TV, which is DVB-C, okay? That's the digital video broadcast over cable TV, yes?
If a main advantage of the OFDM, or the reason of development, is inter-symbol interference,
yeah.
We do not have inter-symbol interference in wire.
You do. Because what happens on wired communication is not multipath, but what happens in wireless communication is that the channel itself is a very limited bandwidth. So what happens when you put a square pulse on a limited bandwidth? It will become smoother and get slower and it will be spread, right? So the spreading here is not because of multipath effect, but because of the band limitation of the channel.
But don't we still have control over this channel? We still have control, so like, why?
I'm not sure what's meant by having control over the channel.
For example, the channel itself, it does not change. For example, Wi-Fi is deployed in small room, big room, a lot of stuff,
okay.
Empty. So we don't know what happened there, but in cables we do know what happened. Like, if they get spread, we know what will happen eventually. So,
so what can we do?
Why OFDM exactly?
Because OFDM allows you to work in that particular situation where you have spreading, which is going to cause inter-symbol interference. Now, I'm not sure what do you mean by we know already what will happen. I mean, we know it will spread, but what can we do about it? We have to do something while transmitting, and that's what we are doing by applying OFDM. Okay, so what else? I mean, otherwise, I mean, at the receiver side, even though you might be aware that every signal is going to spread on the next one, and maybe you know a good estimate of how much it is spreading, but they arrive to you added to each other. So what can you do? You don't know which one is a one, which one is a zero, right, at the receiver side. So if they are not already protected from the transmitter side, at the receiver you have signals accumulated above each other, and you don't know what was sent. So what can you do? So basically you have to still process this at the transmitter side. Okay, so let's look at, you hate equations, but we have to use them a little bit. Okay. So let's look at what happens when you have your signal S of T, and then you are taking that signal over time, so one pulse at a time, and multiplying each one of them with a carrier, right? And those carriers are multiples of each other, correct? That's what exactly we are doing in OFDM system, right? So simply, if your signal is S, right? What you are doing is you are representing that signal as summation of bits. So S1 is the first bit, S2 is the second bit, S3 is the third bit, and so on, right? Okay. So you are taking pieces of that signal, which are those bits,
And you are multiplying each one of them with a carrier,
right?
Which is a multiple of a single carrier. So FK here,
we have F1, F2, F3, F4,
up to
Fn minus 1, starting from F0, which is the fundamental frequency, right? Now, what does this look like? This is a Fourier series expansion of my signal S of t, right? Discrete time Fourier series expansion, right? So simply, I can think of this representation as if those S of k's are the frequency coefficients of my signal, right? And the subcarriers are the Fourier series expansion basis, right? Okay? So if this is the case, if I think of it this way, then I can simply say, okay, if I want my signal S of t, what I should do is generate the frequency symbols, right? The symbols that represents the Fourier series coefficients, Sk, and then take them through an IFFT. What will the IFFT do? It will basically do this operation, right? If I take the SKs and put them all on an IFFT, it's equivalent to multiplying them by e to the j 2 pi FKT, so basically converting to time domain, right? And summing. That's what you do to convert from frequency to time, right? And I will end up that the transmitted signal is S of t, right? So nice implementation. I don't really need to have multiple carriers, generate multiple local oscillators or multiple frequencies, make sure the frequencies are accurate, right? It's simply that I will generate my symbols, right? And then take those symbols, put them in an IFFT block. The IFFT block is going to generate from the other side S of t, right? Which is equivalent to taking each one of those symbols and multiplying it by one of the frequencies. It's exactly the same, right? So this is why the guy came up with the RDM, and because of the implementation. Okay? So the implementation of this will be simply an IFFT block. Any questions about this?
Delta F
هي الكارير سيباريتور. كارير سيباريشن. فريكونسي سيباريشن بين السب كاريرز. That's delta F. Okay.
Correct كده ولا مش correct؟ Now given the fact that just coming back to your
question, تمام؟ Given the fact that those frequencies, if you want to make them as efficient as possible, they should be separated by a duration equal to?
As efficient as possible, B.
B, right?
Yeah, equivalent to the bandwidth of your signal. Tamam? So that delta F needs to be, the minimum delta F needs to be?
B to B.
B to B.
B best? Fibonacci.
Aywa?
Because they will go all of the other signals will be zero.
اوكي فهيبقى السيباريشن قد ايه بي ولا 2 بي بي صح سو دي وات يو نيد از ذات ذا سيباريشن از غانا بي ايكوال تو ذا باند ويث اوف يور سيجنال مظبوط سو ذاتس ذا سيباريشن بتوين 1 اند 2 اوكي ايه تاني وات اذر كويستشنز يو مايت هاف هير
تو يس اي دونت نو اف ات از ا فاليد كويستشن بت ناو اف وي يوز كابل اوف فريكوانسيز بت ذاتس بين يوزد ان وان تايم سلوت And in another time slot, are we going to use the same frequencies or are we going to...
Yeah, of course. It's reused. So you decided to take, for example, your signal 8 bits at a time. You will use 8 frequencies to send the first 8 bits. Then the same 8 frequencies will be used to send the next 8 bits and then the next 8 bits and then the next. So you will keep on all the time using only 8 frequencies. Okay, so you don't keep on expanding in frequency. It will be endless, right? The whole idea was, as the first figure that I showed, right? The whole idea is that you had 8 bits. You decided to send them in parallel. So you took them spread in time, right? And each one is going to be on a subcarrier. So you need 8 subcarriers. What after this? The next 8 bits can be sent over the same subcarrier because already خلاص, the first 8 ones made it, right? So you can send the next ones. Okay? So you don't need to expand in carriers. خلاص. Okay? Yes, any other question?
B, when you say the bandwidth B, it's just the positive part of bandwidth.
Yes. Yeah. And يعني, to make this clearer, I'm not talking about the bandwidth of the signal. I'm basically talking about the duration between one symbol and the next one. خلاص, we are talking about the duration between one pulse and the next one. تمام؟ That duration between one pulse and the next one is going to be equal to your sampling time. So if you decided that your time domain signal, which is represented by certain symbols, those symbols occur every sample time, right? So that sample time is going to be directly the inverse of that delta f. So Ts, t sampling times delta f is equal to 1. Any other questions?
When we look up the, for example, the Wi-Fi, they don't use like B, they use less than B. So the channels, some channels are overlapping.
B, no, they're overlapping because they don't separate them by 2B. مش less than B, no way. So the minimum is B, minimum separation between one and the other. Yeah, so overlapping here means that, I showed you the picture, يعني. Overlapping here means instead of doing this, assume that this is, you only care about the first.
No, I mean overlapping in the frequency domain.
أي والله, ما أنا فاهم, أنا بتكلم على frequency domain. ما هي square في time دي اللي هي bit duration, when you look it up in frequency, it becomes a sync. Assume that you consider all the upcoming ripples as a very small, تمام, all the upcoming ripples, بعد كده very small, so you ignore them. So you consider that your bandwidth is only the main loop of that sync function, تمام؟ What's the duration of this one? What's this?
B.
ده واحد على TB, صح؟ Yeah. Which is bandwidth of your signal, تمام؟ So this is B. Now if you did not use OFDM, if you did not use overlapping, you should have started the next one here. Next, sorry. You should have started the next one here, such that there is no interference, تمام؟ However, because of orthogonality, you were able to say, okay, I can actually do this. I can start the next one such that it's zero at the middle of the next one, right? So in this case, it's separation between D and D to become still B. In this case, it's 2B. You cannot do smaller than this. Cannot go smaller than this. You will have problems. Right? Yes?
On the Wi-Fi channels themselves, we have the 2.4 GHz band. Mm-hmm. It's divided into 13 channels.
Yes.
So we have a channel that overlaps another channel. For example, channel 1 and channel 2. Mm-hmm. They overlap each other. That's what we... So that's correct.
But what I'm seeing in the hydro release standard that you can't use all the channels. You can use 4 out of 14. Yeah. The overlapping channels cannot be used together at the same time.
And ask the allocation of both channels. Ah, okay, but you cannot use...
To a general channel
at the same
time.
That has to do with that. As though the sub-channels don't know how to sub-carriers. This is just to understand. The sub-channels don't are... This is a full band, which is going to be allocated... Full band, actually, which is going to be allocated to, this piece of equipment, as opposed to another band or another piece of equipment, I guess. In Wi-Fi, you don't allocate per client. You allocate per access point. يعني access point الواحدة شغالة على واحد بس من sub-bands دول. تمام؟ And it communicates with all its clients on the same sub-band. So how do they not interfere? They use MAC approach. استخدم protocols على MAC. تمام؟ However, if you have two base stations or two access points in close proximity, then each one of them, واحدة مثلا استخدم لما تخش على adjustment بتاعت الراوتر بتاعها مثلا channel 1 لحد channel 11 تقريبا channel 12 حاجة كده تمام؟ If two exist at the same time, you have to use مثلا channel 1 or channel 5 and not use channel 1 and channel 2
okay.
Because they will interfere with each other, okay? But this has nothing to do with the subcarriers. Don't use subchannels to a subcarrier.
Because we thought we can use 1 and 2 at the same time.
I think no, if you look at the standards, you can.
Okay.
If I remember correctly, yeah.
Okay.
Ethan, what, any other questions?
This was my question.
Okay. So again, don't confuse this with the subcarriers bands. Mm-hmm. These are full bands. نتكلم على Wi-Fi standard بقى away from OFDM. What happens is you have, as he mentioned, you have a 2.4 gig as a middle point. There is a big duration around this, which is considered the ISM band allocated for Wi-Fi, تمام? For Wi-Fi G مثلا, تمام? And then this is divided into some sub-bands. Okay? So your whole system is going to be working in one of these. If they are overlapping, then this means you cannot use two systems on two adjacent channels. You have to use two systems that are co-located in some separate channel. You cannot use two that overlap with each other.
So if we have four routers, they will take each channel 1, channel 5, channel 9, channel
7. Yeah, make sure they are allocated on different non-overlapping channels.
And if we increase, put 7 Wi-Fi in the router, for example?
They will not work. Yeah, so some of them will interfere. That's one of the problems with Wi-Fi, that when you have co-located routers, there is a possibility of interference. That's what happens, for example, at home. If you have too many people around your place and they are close enough and the walls are not causing enough attenuation, it might be very difficult for you to figure out which band to use. هتلاقي كل ما تشغل الراوتر بتاعك في حاجة, try to connect to the router, it gives you weak signal. معنى انت قريب جدا من الراوتر, طب يديني weak signal ليه? Because someone else is overlapping with your channel. So you're not using a clear enough channel. Yes.
If the antenna of the Wi-Fi or whatever it is, the base station for example, is directed to a specific area or does have an azimuth or whatever, so we can, I think we can work on both sides with the same.
Yeah, but typically Wi-Fi is, again, you are in mostly indoor environment, right? So even if the antenna is directed somewhere, reflections will cause this to spread all over the place. That's number one. Number two, Wi-Fi typically don't use that directive antenna because it can be very harmful if you move your if you move your client from one place to the other. يعني أنا قاعد أهو هنا Wi-Fi شغال. أروح أنا الترابيزة اللي هناك Wi-Fi تبطل. This is really bad. تمام? Very directive antennas, they will cause the signal to be much weaker there as compared to here. But that's not the typical uses. They do use antennas that gives them a little bit of a gain, but they are wide beam antennas typically, so they don't provide that much directivity. What else? So can we delay the questions on Wi-Fi a little bit until we finish the rest of the OFDM system? Yes?
Can you read the part of IFFT block?
The IFFT block, okay. Which part is not clear? Is it where the equation comes from, or how does this equation represent an IFFT?
Yes, this one.
How it represents an IFFT? Look at it, okay? What we have here is some coefficients that are multiplied by e to the j 2 by f. T, تمام? And the F's are different as you change the coefficient.
لكل coefficient عندي F مختلف, تمام?
If I pick those F's such that they are multiples of each other,
اللي هو condition بتاع ال OFDM, for the OFDM,
then this becomes as if it is S0 e to the J 2 pi F0 T.
تمام?
بعدين S1 e to the J 2 pi F0
مضروب في 2 T.
وبعدين S 2 e to the j 2 pi
3 f 0 t وهكذا. This expression, if you do it from 0 to n minus 1, is the exact expression of the FFT.
لو انت عندك حاجة بتعملها FFT بيطلع شكل FFT كده. But this is not the FFT, it's the inverse FFT. لأن احنا هنا بنغير الفريكونسي وبخليه
التايم is extending with us, the same time, same t. فكأننا بنعمل conversion from frequency domain to time domain. تمام؟
So this is equivalent to doing an IFFT with those values. What these values should be if I want this to be the IFFT of this. These values should be the frequency coefficients of this signal.
So this 1F0, 2F0, 3F0 is correspond to F1, F2, F3,
the اللي هم Omega 2, Omega 3, Omega اللي نستخدمهم في الـ في الـ في الـ Fourier series expansion. Okay.
So to demodulate, you only use FFT?
Yes. At the modulator, at the demodulator side, you use the FFT. So you bring back S1, S2, the symbols that were carrying your information. Any other questions? So one important thing, which is a little bit counter to what we are used to, is that when you are using OFDM, you consider your modulated signal, S1, S2, S3, whatever, you consider them as if they are frequency domain coefficients. Mm-hmm. And that's why you take them through IFFT. فإذا كده طالع عندك time domain signal transmitted over the channel, وعم ترجع في receiver تاني تعمل إيه؟ تدخلهم في FFT block, so they become again S1, S2, اللي هم كأنهم frequency domain representations. تمام؟ هم actually just modulated signals, هم على frequency domain واحد. What you care about is that you got them again and they have the information that you need. خلاص؟ Okay. So this is the typical block. If you don't use an FFT, that I already described it currently, you have a series of symbols or bits, if you want to deal at the smallest case, you convert them to parallel, right? With each one of them expanded to cover the whole duration, right? And then you multiply each one of them with a subcarrier, and then you add them together so that you get your subcarrier modulated signal. Tamam? At the receiver, you do the inverse operation. We found from the expression that this is the receiver side. Tamam? You want to look at it, and if you have any comments or if it's not clear before I move on, I will leave it to you. Look at it for like 5-10 seconds. Look and see whether you understand how it operates or not. Before asking the question, just see whether this is clear or not. هنرجع اللي قبله بس شوف ده شغال ولا لا. لا مش شغال؟
اوكي.
So simply you have your received signal, you take that and demodulate it by multiplying it by the F's again, right? So the first one is going to give you
the signal of the first carrier.
Yeah, and the second one, the signal of the second carrier, the third one, the signal of the third carrier, and then what do you do? Why do you integrate from 0 to T and sample?
This is matched filter.
The matched filter, not low filter. Okay, so this is matched filtering, and then you get to the detector. I think this one, if you want to do it really, really correct, you should say that I have here a low pass filter, such that you don't get the replica images.
But yes. Why do we need a low pass filter? Because, for example, I have a signal with carrier 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. From a multiplied by carrier 1 with 1, I get a signal. But 1 with 2, I get 0.
That's true. Yeah. That's true.
But so why we
low pass filter here is not because when I multiply it by F1, I will have F2 and F3 because they are all orthogonal.
Yeah.
The problem is when I multiply a signal by the same carrier, I will get the signal at the baseband and double the band, right? So I need to remove that double the band from the picture. Okay. Okay. Any other questions? So the actual implementation looks like this. Okay, so you have, forget about these. The important thing is that you have bits here, right? And then those bits or symbols are converted from serial to parallel. They go through an IFFT, right? And then they are converted. Oh, I forgot to mention that. Then they are converted back to serial, right?
Yes,
because you cannot send parallel data over the channel. Channel, wireless channel can only take one symbol at a time. فاشتغل عليها multiple symbols at a time. Multiple symbols. فاشتغل عليها.
Can you, like, this is where we all fight together.
Okay.
We spent 2 hours on that fight. So please explain this further. Parallel to serial. Like, why can't we send parallel?
How can you do it?
If after FFT, like, I have the input to that IFFT, are different, like, there are symbols in the FFT, each one goes on a different carrier, or different coefficient that represents a carrier of a conversion.
Please.
So, when I, the output of IFFT will be like 10 main segments, I'll just sum them together and put them on an antenna. So I get in time domain a signal that changes, that is frequency representation, is the frequency representation of the inputs.
Summing them together?
Yeah,
but summing them together will give you.
If I sum them together in time, still in frequency they are separated, each one is on serial. And I can put it in one antenna.
Each one of those is okay. So if you look at this IFFT, it's not producing.
How do I describe this to you?
Okay. How do you do an FFT? Because don't forget that here we are not doing an FFT of only one thing. We are doing an FFT of multiple things, multiple symbols together, multiple the parallel ones. So the resultant time domain coefficients are going to be multiple pulses. Each one of them is a representation of a combination of the IFFTs of the inputs. So if you sum them, you have lost the fact that you can recover them at the receiver using an FFT. If you add them together, what will you end up with? In the coefficients that are on IFFTD, at one value.
Now at the receiver, what will you do with this?
You can separate them.
Why is it not valid?
But you added them together, you end up with one value.
But value to FFT, so the input to FFT, each signal it has in the FFT list itself, I multiply it by a different carrier.
Okay.
So the output, we have 10 domain signals, but each has different bandwidth than the other. If we sum them, we get one 10 domain signal that has data separated in different bandwidths.
And the input, you did an FFT of multiple symbols together, which symbol right?
Okay.
You did an IFFT here with multiple symbols, which the symbol right? You did multiple symbols, multiple samples, and as a matter of fact. And then the symbol, the whole world in Zakla, or the whole world in Zakla. And you did it with one symbol, but that symbol is composed of multiple samples. Basically, multiples of your modulated constellations. واحدة والتانية والبعدها 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 typically according to the data that came to you, right? And then you take all of these together, you made an IFFT for them. That's gonna produce equivalently number of coefficients, تمام؟ If you take those number of coefficients and you add them together, you will end up with a single coefficient, not sum بتاعهم. صح؟
Yeah.
You added them, فمجموعهم هتطلع حاجة. One value. I have at the output, for example, T1, T2, T3, T4, up to T8. Now we're talking about 8 FFT. تمام? Now, if I keep them as T1, T2, T3, I'm fine. وحطهم serial. Then at the receiver, I'll add them parallel ودخلهم تاني على FFT. فطلعوا لي من ناحية تانية S1, S2 لحد S8. مظبوط? طيب. If I added them T1 plus T2 plus T3 plus T4 لحد T8. بقى عندي value سميها Z. What would I do with this Z at the receiver?
The receiver, if I demodulate it, I'll get
a single value.
You can't separate.
I got a single value. فعملها demodulation طلع لي single value. وبعدين رجعهم 8 تاني ازاي.
Maybe there's a bit misconception. We might talk later.
Okay. هنتكلم عليها دي. Okay. So you convert this to parallel, you perform the IFFT, and then you have to convert it to serial such that you maintain the fact that they are 8 symbols. You need to deal with 8 symbols here, تمام? And you send them over the channel, forget about the guard interval, I will talk about it later. At the receiver side, you convert them again to parallel, you talk them through an FFT, and then, don't forget about this, this is about handling the channel effect, okay? Important thing is that you convert them back to serial and you start processing them to get your original data. What was your question?
The final thing that was transmitted from the front end will be the block?
Will be the block, yes. Will be the OFDM symbol or OFDM block, it depends. Sometimes it's you get multiple of these and you accumulate them and then you send them. It depends on the technology.
And they will be Come sent on. As...
Or sometimes you just send one symbol at a time.
Then they will be sent on one carrier at that time?
Everything is going to be sent on one carrier. One carrier, which sub-carrier. Sub-carrier is cost out of the life of the team.
Okay.
So allocation of sub-carriers is done by the IFT operation itself.
So what's the idea of converting back from parallel to serial? Because you already have a parallel with a expanded time, okay? Then if you want to maintain this characteristic, you'll have much larger time span. I mean, that's what...
I will not have much larger time span. No. Why do I have much larger... I did not... Here, in this operation... Can talk. In this operation, I did not actually... spread them over. I did the effect mathematically by doing the IFFT, but I did not do spreading in real world. Yeah. Okay, when I took them from serial to parallel, I just made them parallel. They go into the IFFT. I don't really need it. We are not dealing even with pulse shapes here. We are dealing with values. على طول يا جماعة. You got my idea? Well, probably this is why you are okay. Think of it this way. خلاص عشان اريحك
Think of it.
هو فعلا naming is important. Okay, that's why they call them the particular names that I mentioned.
Think of it as if what you have here are samples of your frequency domain signal.
تمام؟ You took those samples of your frequency. يعني كأن عندك one signal in the frequency domain اللي هما ال parallel bits اللي أنت بتتكلم عليهم دول. تمام؟
Now these samples of the summation of those parallel bits, تمام؟ are going into an IFFT.
You will get at the output samples of your time domain signal. So all these, تمام؟ needs to be بدل ما هما كده يتفردوا كده عشان تكون منهم ال time domain signal. That's why they call them samples. فكرش فيه مع النوم bits. خلاص؟ So what's happening here is you have a signal. You assume that as if it is represented in frequency domain by those modulation symbols, تمام؟ اللي هما طالعين من constellations, تمام؟ But you think of these as samples of your frequency domain signal. As if you have collectively, out of these eight, the samples of your frequency domain representation. مش انت لما بتعمل FFT بيطلع لك الناحية التانية discrete frequency representation؟ صح؟ That's a one representation with samples. So think of these as samples of your frequency domain representation. They go into the IFFT. They will produce on the other side what? Samples of your time domain representation. صح؟ مظبوط؟
تمام؟ خلينا نتكلم على الثمانية اللي احنا بنتكلم عليها. So these are 5, 6, 7, let's say 8. خلاص؟ This is a sampled version of your signal spectrum. تمام؟ يعني ده signal spectrum بتاعنا كان شكل more or less حاجة شبه كده. Okay؟ And this is the sampled version of this. تمام؟ You take this through an IFFT block. What you will get from the other side? دول التمانية اللي بيخشوا parallel. دول التمانية اللي بتدخلوا فيها parallel على IFFT block. تمام؟ What will you get from the other side? Again, 8 coefficients. Those 8 coefficients are samples of your time domain signal. ممكن يبقى شكلهم مثلا حاجة عاملة كده. Maybe even almost a square ولا whatever. يطلع شكله زي ما يطلع. كده كام؟ 9
8
كده 8 خلاص يبقى مظبوط. اوكي
سو ذاتس وات يو ويل جيت فروم ذا اذر سايد بارل. تمام؟ اف يو وونت تو سند ذس سيجنال تو ذا ريسيفر وات يو هاف تو دو تقلبها كده وتبعتها سامبلز اور اوف ا تايم دومين سيجنال. عشان تبعت التايم دومين سيجنال هتعمل فيها ايه؟
واحده
هتبعت سامبل اكتر من كده. اف يو ادد ذيس سامبلز توجذر معناها ان انت عملت لهم كولابس كده ان ا سنجل فاليو اند ذن وات كان يو دو
ان ذا اي اف اس تي بلوك I only change the coefficient. I don't multiply them by carrier. Like
carrier. It is equivalent. هو بيعمل ايه؟ life team. دخله من ناحية time domain representation. Sorry, frequency domain representation. يطلع من ناحية تانية time domain. Discrete frequency domain representation. يطلع من ناحية تانية discrete time domain. تمام؟ احنا ورينا mathematically in this operation is equivalent to taking those input symbols ولا samples that multiply them by carriers that are orthogonal to each other. فقلنا good idea, then I will generate every 8 modulated symbols, هاخدهم هعتبرهم كأنهم samples of my frequency domain signal, وهم دخلوا على IFFT, يطلع لي الناحية الثانية time domain representation اللي هي equivalent إن كل واحد من دول حط على carrier orthogonal على الثاني. تمام؟ وروح بعيد. At the receiver, I will do the endless operation, I will recover my symbols again. تمام؟ Now, those symbols, when I used them over the IFFT and the FFT block, I was thinking of them as samples from the time domain representation and samples from the frequency domain representation. صح؟ ما ينفعش اخد samples of my time domain representation or my frequency domain representation واجمعهم على بعض ولهم كولابس، مش هيطلع لي حاجة. كده كأن السيجنال كلها بقت one pulse. ما ينفعش. Okay? Is it clearer دلوقتي ولا لسه مش واضحة؟ Separate the two things. What we did is we found that the FFT and the IFFT is equivalent operation. Now we are using the IFFT. Okay. Don't forget that in baseband, we don't actually have any pulse shape yet. Pulse shape that is the same. But I'm talking about values. These values
if I need to process them through an IFFT block, as if they are samples of my frequency representation, my time representation, لازم عشان ارجعهم لاشرح لهم الاصلي لازم يبقوا سيريس، ما ينفعش اقول التايم دومين بتاعي ريبريزنتد بحاجه كده بس، وان بلس وخلاص. It has to be represented over time with certain samples، صح؟
And then these samples, we have 8 samples. We have to send them over the time.
بالظبط.
So when we use a modulation type that we know already, for example, PSK or
لا، ده already happened before. That already happened then.
It's simple number.
So these samples are actually the output of the constellation. Now, what I need to do with them is consider them now as one symbol. نسميه OFDM symbol. أو إذا كنت هتجمع مجموعة كبيرة منهم نسميها OFDM block. تاخد كل symbol ده تعمله pulse shaping, تعمله upsampling و pulse shaping وبعد تحطه على الكارير اللي هو 2.4 gain. تمام؟
So I have a final signal that I'm sending over the channel. The frequency representation of this implementation technique is different than the frequency representation of using like different carriers.
If you use multiple carriers, it will be different than this one.
Different.
يعني ما تقول ده multiple carriers.
حضرتك مش فاهم.
Physically.
Okay, how would this one will look, the bandwidth of this one, how would it look like?
It's going to be 2.5.
عندك samples, اهي تمام؟ بينهم duration. الduration ده كأنه sampling time, صح؟ مش هو ده samples جديد, time domain representation, في بينهم duration هنا كأنه sampling time, time plus. If you are using a typical بقى حسب انت عندي pulse shape اللي هتستخدمه طلع لك الباندويث. بس في الآخر, it is it is something which is highly related to what's the separation between once انت بتطلع دول بريت قد ايه بس
فانت لو طلعت it will take all the carriers m carriers for
example ماشي
you see that the bandwidth of the m carriers will be
ما هو انت عشان بتسلكت الكاريرز already equivalent للسامبلنج تايم between الفريكوانسي دومين ريبريزنتيشن ف yes it will look as if it's adding all carriers with a little bit more additional part it will be n plus 1 multiplied by delta f That's going to be the bandwidth.
It will look like this using
the... هنشوفها في الاسبكترال هنشوفها في النكست سلايد.
Before being multiplied by the 2.4 gigahertz carrier, how does the baseband signal look like?
هنشوفها دلوقتي في النكست سلايد. Okay. Multiplying by carrier, بس بيشيفت them, doesn't do anything more than that.
So in the baseband, we have the small carriers.
برضو?
I mean, yeah.
هوريك شكلها هوريك شكلها وهتصدق تلاقي any other questions
سؤال ليش استخدمنا الايفون
طب ممكن نمشي من السلايد دي ماشي ها جو اهيد
ليش استخدمنا الايفون ليش ما استخدمنا الاي دي اف تي سكريبت
عشان this is much more efficient ده اسمه fast Fourier transform استخدم الابطا ليه خلاص ايه تاني any other questions okay. So forget about. I'm not gonna discuss the mathematics that are written here. It just shows you that it more or less it discusses the fact that you can represent the Fourier transform by matrix representation. This is for people who are interested in more mathematical representations. Your lab is starting in 10 minutes. The property of that matrix which represents the Fourier transform operation, the FFT or the IFFT operation, is that it has this important property that F Hermitian multiplied by, like matrix multiplication by itself, is equal to identity matrix. Anyone knows what's a Hermitian of a matrix? It's the transpose conjugation, right? So you take F, you transpose it, and then you take the conjugate of every single element. Okay. If you do that operation, you get F Hermitian. If you multiply it by F itself, which is before doing anything, you should get an identity matrix. So simply, you can say that F Hermitian is the inverse of F, right? Because if something is multiplied by a matrix is equal to identity, then that thing must be the inverse of that matrix. Correct? Mm-hmm. But this works with F times F minus 1, F minus 1 times F, or not? Had the faker? The matrix multiplication. If I say F times F minus 1, okay, this should give me identity. What about F minus 1 times F?
No, it's not
ان ذس انا ما بتكلمش على الجنرال، بتكلم على السبيشال كيس اللي انا بحكي عليها دي. از ترو ولا نوت ترو؟ طب نفكر فيها كده. واتس اف ماينس 1 ماينس 1 ايه هو الانفرس بتاع اف ماينس 1؟ اف صح مظبوط. فيبقى لو انا عندي هنا اف ماينس 1 وضربتها في دي كاني بضربها في الانفرس بتاعها، المفروض تديني ايه؟ ايدنتيتي صح؟ تمام. بات اي نو ذات اف ماينس 1 سوري اي نو ذات ذس از اف صح؟ يبقى ديفينتلي اف ماينس 1 كروس اف از ايكوال تو ايدنتيتي اند اف كروس اف ماينس 1 از ايكوال تو ايدنتيتي. طبعا هما ليه بينفعوا؟ عشان دايما احنا ما نعرفش نجيب ماينس، ما نعرفش نجيب انفرس غير في سكوير ماتريكس، فتضرب من الشمال تضرب من اليمين ات وورك يعني. اوكي you cannot get an inverse for a non-square matrix. Non-square matrix has something called pseudo-inverse, but forget about it دلوقتي. Later, you can study it if you need. Okay. So, the spectrum that everyone was asking about, you can easily figure it out, right? We already mentioned from the beginning that it is those guys overlapping. So when you do that overlapping, you get something like this. Now, this is baseband. If you multiply it by a carrier, it will have the same thing but moved around the carrier. So that's the typical spectrum of an FFT signal. And it was mentioned in the previous slide that the typical bandwidth is equal to n plus 1 multiplied by delta, اللي هي b, bandwidth of the signal, delta f. Okay. Now, last thing that we did not have time to discuss, have to do it before you go to your lab, okay, is the use of guard bands, and then smart use of guard bands is through the usage of cyclic prefix. Right? I already mentioned this briefly last time to you, that the problem is that at the receiver side, you can have situations where either, number one, your symbol, your RDM symbol, is shifted a little bit, so you are not really timed correctly in order to figure out where is the start and where is the end of the symbol. Or actually even think of the case where some symbol interblock interference. So some blocks are going to spread a little bit and interfere in the next block. Okay? To overcome this problem, you need to leave gaps between right, the blocks. Right? Allow a little bit extra space, which is wasted space, right? In order for this spreading to not happen, right? But then this would not solve the problem of timing. So in order to simplify the solution of the problem of timing, we fill this gap, the guard between one symbol and the next one, and instead of leaving it empty, okay, we fill it with a copy of the end of our RDM symbol. So we take some of the samples here, we copy them, and then we paste them at the start, right? End result is that this FFT symbol or FFT word or FFT block is going to be larger, right? But the extra part is not useful information. However, it's going to be useful to overcome problems of the channel. Now, if the previous one interferes a little bit, it's only going to affect the guard part, right? If a shift happens, okay, it doesn't matter. Why? Because as I mentioned to you, the FFT and the IFFT operation already assumes that your signal in time and frequency looks like this, right? So if this is my frequency domain, it's repeated again, right? Same thing is repeated again. And then it's repeated again, right? That's the default for discrete time and discrete frequency, that the signal has to be periodic in time and periodic in frequency, right? So the same thing from time domain perspective. If you look at it, you will find that it has to be periodic because the frequency is discrete, right? Okay. So if this is the case, it means that when I take power and put it here, it's as if I've taken this, like it's as if I've taken those. So think of it this way, as if I've done this. Okay? So as if I'm already considering the extra part that I left is actually compliant to the periodicity of the representation. So if I pick the starting symbol a little bit incorrectly, and instead of picking this one, I pick this one, for example, because of timing issues, I will still have a full period of my signal, and the FFT at the receiver side is going to produce correct version of this signal. Okay? So that's why instead of leaving the guard
which is used to overcome any inter-block or inter-symbol interference issues, instead of leaving it empty, we actually use cyclic prefix. Okay? Can anyone come up with another advantage of using the cyclic prefix?
Can we use it for synchronization?
Yes. So basically, we know now that every symbol that comes to us will have an end part that looks similar to the start part, right? And that, if you look at it from a correlation feature perspective, will cause periodic correlation to appear in your, right, in your autocorrelation function. So now using some correlation techniques at the receiver side, you can figure out the frequency of the symbols. So I have one symbol, another symbol, a third symbol, and so on, right? Because of that existing feature of periodic similarity between end and start of each symbol, right? So we will have a like a peak that appears every periodic duration. They call it cyclostationary peaks, okay? And in this case, this can be used also for synchronization and timing alignment, okay? One more thing is that even if you don't have pilots, okay, and you manage to decode this symbol correctly, okay, you know already that this should look like this. Using this information, you can solve for the channel coefficients, right? So that's another, because if I was able to decode these, and this becomes known to me. Once these are known to me, I can use the fact that they were received with certain gain, and I know what they should look like, so I can calculate that gain. And by this, I've calculated the channel gain, right? So that's also another usage of cyclic prefix. Any questions? Yes. I think it's a matter of standards. I don't know if of an advantage of one of them over the other. في standards بستخدم الاثنين كمان.
I don't think it's a حسب channel. I need standards. هو على حسب the channel duration بتاعه يعني هاخد مثلا عشر الداتا وربع الداتا وخمس الداتا. طبعا I'm trying to make this as small as possible, but it depends on which channel characteristics I want to work on. Of course, it's defined in the standards as well, so you cannot have a Wi-Fi that has a cyclic prefix different from the other, but they designed this for the typical environment of that Wi-Fi system. لا, look it up in the standard, because everyone has something different. The G, variable A, variable F, B. So look it up in the standards. You will find what's the exact size of it. It's not an open number. Sometimes they leave it as a parameter. يعني ساعات الستاندرز بتقول لك you can work with واحد أو اثنين أو ثلاثة. Multiple options, يعني. But in this case, you have to make sure that the client and the access point are both adjusted to the same characteristics.
This card is has to be inserted on the transmitter side.
Of course.
Like this one is a, as I understood, it's a property of the discrete Fourier transform.
Yes.
But when we use fast Fourier transform, is it affected?
Fast Fourier transform is just a fast algorithm that performs discrete Fourier transform.
Okay. Okay. So it's just the same. Yeah. It's another route for the same one.
Yes. Any other questions? Oh, okay. Questions for them? I wanted to talk about the peak to average, but it's just a disadvantage. Read about it. Doesn't matter.